dinner at his residence where he presented his credentials. Also, in Kuala, both China and Australia share Commonwealth values for democracy, human rights, and governance and rule of law. Responded to the calls for help during Cyclone Gabrielle if they didn't have the right gear. They sank hundreds of people but ruined their personal wetsuits and the contaminated floodwaters. SAF Life Saving New Zealand is now asking emergency authorities to replace the ruined gear. But they have been told they should not have gone out of rescues without the right equipment. SAF Life Saving's Alan Mundy says they are trying to get the right gear or the right suit, so there's no government money for it.
All members of the community put them in the position of saying, well, I made the right decision because I've still got my, $250 wet suit intact, but three or four people drowned. That's what we're talking about here.
Alan Mundy says the aid of rescue system is not keeping pace with the rising threat of flooding. In world news, taking regular naps during the day could have positive effects on brain health, according to a new study from the University College London. The research using volunteers between 40 and 69 years of age suggests napping may slow down the rate of brain shrinkage associated with aging. The BBC's James Gallagher reports.
If you've ever fancied finding a quiet corner and just nodding off for 10 minutes of peace, then science might be on your side. Some people's DNA or genetic code makes them more likely to nap. And a team at University College London compared those who were genetic nappers with those primed to power through the day. The results, published in the journal Sleep Health, showed a napping trait led to brains that were 15 cubic centimetres larger. The team said that was equivalent to delaying brain ageing by 3 to 6 years.
French financial investigators are conducting searches at the headquarters of the organizing committee for next year's Olympic Games in Paris. They are investigating how contracts for construction projects were awarded. The BBC's Hugh Schofield reports.
Anti-corruption investigators arrived unannounced at the headquarters of the Olympics Organising Committee in Saint-Denis in the northern Paris suburbs, as well as at the offices of the public body Solideo, which is in charge of building projects for the Games, including the athletes and media villages. The organising committee said it was cooperating fully with the police while looking into allegations of favouritism and misuse of public money in the attribution of certain construction contracts.
In other sports news, Fiji Rugby says it is in serious debt with more than $1.5 million owed to creditors. Fiji Village reports the chair of Fiji Rugby Football Union Trust Board, Peter Maisie, saying a review is being undertaken. Maisie told Fiji Village a plan of action to address the debt is in place. He said they are reviewing everything to enable the trustees to set up a new structure that would progress the union. Ghana will test its Rugby World Cup squad against Australia A in July. The game takes place in Tonga. There are heavy fans of expectations for Tonga stars to the team, which boasts the likes of Israel Folau, Malachi Fixua, Adam Coleman and Chris Piotel. This year marks the 50th anniversary of Tonga's historic victory and the Wallabies in 1973. And we wish them all the best soon. And that's your news and sports. For more about headlines and stories, head to rngi.com.
Hello, Panava. You're listening to Pacific Wave from RNG Pacific. Following more, also sign up through Suzuki. Coming up, Energy Dino talks about the US security deal, what it means for PNG. Also,
threats of climate change are things that I can't deal with immediately, but these other threats we can deal with.
Damaged coral reefs in Kitabasa, I mean, and later on, I think it's a good selection of players that we have across the board. The check in the Fiji are all preparations for the next World Cup.
security deal the United States has signed with Papua New Guinea will inevitably make the country more militarized. Last week, the PNG Parliament was called on to ratify the shipyard agreements and the defense cooperation agreements signed last month in Port Moresby by the U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken and PNG Defense Minister Win Daki. Don Rothman spoke with a University of PNG political scientist, currently studying at the Australian National University, Michael Kaboni, and began by asking him if the deal is good for Papua New Guineans.
Well, there are two sides to everything. I think lots of the debate is driven by misinformation and lack of information, and the government being very secretive about the deal and not releasing the information earlier. So, yeah, when you look at the deal, part of it comes with what I call a seek right agreement, which allows U.S. and PNG marine military personnel to ride on each other's seat, but mostly for PNG Navy and observers to ride on the U.S. Navy. And much of the concerns around PNG's marine security has been its huge exclusive economic zone. So it's about 2.7 million kilometers square. And Papua New Guinea has had ability of capacity to manage its borders. So we really don't know what goes on the fringes of Papua New Guinea's borders, marine border that is. The recent increase in drugs being found, the PNG drugs, like cocaine, 500 kilograms of cocaine passed in PNG, I think it was in 2020, and methamphetamine, increasing cases of methamphetamine found in PNG, and these are not natural products that are naturally found in PNG, so we know it's coming from overseas. PNG is acting as a transit kind of point for these illicit drugs to enter, mostly because of unregulated borders. So the deal itself, in a way, helps Papua New Guinea address these challenges that Papua New Guinea hasn't had the capacity to address before.
Because of the size of that event, if the Americans are going to effectively release it, they're going to have so many vessels there. It sounds crazy.
Yeah, that's the other side of the coin, right? U.S. history around the world is whenever they sign a deal with another country, especially if it's a developing poor country, that region becomes heavily militarized, whether it's in the Middle East, even if it's some country relatively powerful like Pakistan, or even in the Pacific Islands, you can take Guam, for instance. It becomes heavily militarized. And it is naive to think that Australia, and especially the United States, is coming into the Pacific with the sole purpose of helping the Pacific. And I don't know what it is. I think the politicians, especially PNG politicians, are either too naive or the benefits are just too much for them to ignore. So the deal between Papua New Guinea and the United States comes with more than $400 million to support. This is money that James Marape wouldn't turn down. It's money he needs. For that purpose, studying PNG politics and the behavior of PNG politicians for the last 5 years. When I heard that it comes to $450 million, I knew from the outset that this deal will be signed. And not only for the benefits, and as an analyst, I see the benefit of securing PNG's borders. But even if it wasn't for PNG's borders and securing its security, this deal would have been signed because of the amount of money that's attached to it.
This money is presumably going to go into these camps, which are effectively going to be little bits of America scattered around PNG, aren't they? There's no immediate benefit that's going to accrue to PNG from that money.
Well, part of the agreement is the U.S. military will have unlimited access to the main ports of PNG, so both wharves and marine ports, as well as airports and airstrips. And there's a massive infrastructure going on at the moment in Manus that will allow U.S. Navy to park. So you're right, the money, we don't know the breakdown of the funds, how much would be used, for guaranteeing the security of the marine battleship population and how much would be used for infrastructure.
Yeah, like I said, if you look at the experience of the United States elsewhere,
you're probably right that a huge chunk of money will go into building this infrastructure so that the United States can access it.
There's a lot of emphasis on Manus Island, which is very far north of the rest of PNG, isn't it? North American Air Force base there.
Yeah, you're right. Much of what's happening is shaped by history, especially the Second World War and the Cold War and what happened in the 1960s with Malaysia and Indonesia, what came to be known as Confrontasi. And PNG, among all Pacific Island countries, proved to be a very important battle zone in reversing the Japanese forces during the Cold War. It was regarded as a buffer zone between communism and Australia. PNG was this country bordering all the Southeast Asian countries pulling on the communism. And Manus in particular is an important strategic piece of real estate in the Pacific. It proved to be very important in the Japanese, U.S. And allied war in the 1940s, 1942. So, you know, if there's going to be any island that, let's say, China need to secure to be able to advance south and into the Pacific, that would be Manus. And it's also this island, if you wanted to build up your military forces and installation and to guarantee the security of the southern hemisphere, it has to be Manus. So, yeah, Manus is becoming is very important. Island in Papua New Guinea, both Australia and China is also interested in that. So there is talks that apart from the US and Australia building a naval base in Manus, China is building a commercial one. But when you look at the commercial, this applies to not only Manus, but the Pacific. When China gets involved in building wharves, though it, you know, it appears to be a wharf for commercial ships to park, it's built with the equipment to hold military naval ships. So even though it appears to be a commercial infrastructure, or just another infrastructure, the equipment that's used to measurement, the specifications that goes into building this, can easily accommodate.